Good afternoon. My name is Arjan Terhuis. I'm a senior research engineer for TNO, working in the field of autonomous driving research. Next I'm going to talk about automated driving, the challenges in automated driving, the developments on methodology, assessments and applications. Required functionalities for an automated driving application. And further, I will show you some examples of projects that we did on the topic of autonomous or automated driving. And finally, a wrap-up. So, the cars that we buy today have actually all the ingredients on the actuator side to perform autonomous driving. We can start the vehicle without an ignition key by pressing a button on the dashboard. We can accelerate, we can brake, we can steer. So all the ingredients on that side are there to remove the driver from the vehicle and let it take over by a control application. Another important aspect of course is that humans use sight to make decisions. So also on that part, vehicles are equipped with sensors that can look around, detect objects in order to stay within lanes. And therefore, we can drive with those kind of applications on the freeway. However, sensors may fail sometimes. And the application, the control application, needs to deal with that. But the question always is, how do you deal with it? And even if those sensors are not failing, they still may suffer from the environmental conditions, such as bad weather or very dark or very bright environments, which poses problems for the camera system. Another thing which may go wrong in such applications is the incorrect detection of and classification of objects a camera system, for example, is seeing. So how do you deal with that? The same holds for infrastructure. When you encounter roadworks, for example, how should such a system deal with it? Furthermore, there's the unpredictability of other road users. For example, vehicles making sudden lane changes that you don't expect, or braking suddenly, or pedestrians crossing the road at positions where they're not supposed to. And those are all things that you need to take into account when designing safe autonomous driving applications. At this moment in time, there is, at least not to my knowledge, a system that can really handle all the kinds of different situations and dangerous situations that a vehicle, or human in this case, will encounter in its lifetime. So full autonomous driving at this moment in time is not on the market. Therefore, a system of autonomy levels has been developed, ranging from level 0 to level 5, where level 0 is mainly using perception sensors to inform and to warn the driver, whereas on the other end of the spectrum, you have the level 5 automation applications, which mean that these cars, these applications can really take and all decisions by themselves in all kind of situations. In the meantime, the applications have progressed from level 0 to level 2 to level 3 automation, and some even claim to have level 4 automation. But mainly, we are now in the era of level 3 applications. Things like traffic jam assist or parking aids or lane keeping system, highway pilots, that kind of applications. One important factor there is that you always need the human inside the vehicle. Whenever such a system cannot handle the situation properly, the human needs to take over. Vast amounts of money are being spent on achieving or reaching the level 5 automation. That is considered as the holy grail in autonomous driving. And also TNO is doing research on in level 4, level 5 automation. But we're not so much focusing on the functional performance or the applications itself, but more on the safety side. So how can you develop an application in a safe way, such that all of these ingredients of an autonomous driving application, such as overtaking, braking, and all that kind of things, how do you ensure that all those functions are working safely and robust and properly together? So safety is one of the main drivers for the research of TNO on this this field. And as TNO, we're not only looking at the theory of the application, but we also want to make that bring that into practice. Therefore, a lot of projects on these kind of architecture, safe architectures, have been implemented in real-life demonstrators. Also on the human-machine interaction, TNO performs a lot of research, as been mentioned already by the previous speaker, a lot of research on human behavior modeling, and because that is important in a car, that a driver should always be up for the task of taking over control. So you need to monitor the driver and interact with it and see if it's ready to take over the control. On the other side, since we have vast knowledge on safety and vehicle dynamics, and also on the functions of autonomous driving vehicles, we can help out authorities in the setting up of legislation and regulation and assessment methodologies. So what does a vehicle, or what does an autonomous vehicle consist of? Mainly, it consists of four major building blocks. First of all, you need to know where you are. That's called localization. And typically, you use sensor fusion techniques for that. At TNO, we have developed, especially for this case of localization, our in-house sensor fusion framework, in which we use vehicle models to combine all kind of motion sensor data from the wheel speed, for example, or from accelerometers, from position sensors such as GPS. We all fuse them together into achieving and obtaining a robust and accurate estimate of our own position. Then, of course, you need to know the surrounding traffic, or the situation around you. So who are around me? For that, we use a different type of sensors called perception sensors, such as cameras, lidars, radars, even also communication with roadside units. And again, we will fuse all of these sensor information, sensor observations, into a one single view of the world around us. That's called object tracking. But once you know where all the objects are, that's not enough. You should also know where they're going to. So object prediction. And at TNO, we do research on that topic as well, by looking into methods based on kinematic or dynamic models of auto traffic, combined with algorithms based on artificial intelligence, for example, in order to predict the motions of the vehicle around us for the next, let's say, 5 to 10 seconds. Then you need to know where you're going to. So path planning, decision making, situation awareness, all with the goal of finding out how to move from your current position to some other goal position. Once you have that trajectory, the path, you should operate, or you should move your vehicle along that. And for that, you need to control the vehicle in a safe and stable way, of course, but also the drivers or the passengers inside the vehicle, they are not operating the car themselves. So you should also make sure that these motions are being comfortable. So the control should be comfortable, safe, and stable. And all of those functions, the four functions, the main building blocks of an autonomous application, should of course work together in a safe and reliable way. So you should guarantee with the architecture that you have designed, you should guarantee reliability and integrity of the complete application. One of the examples of bringing autonomous applications into practice is the truck platooning example. Why do you want truck platoons? First of all, the main reason is fuel safety, for example. Driving closer together reduces the air drag of the second and the third and fourth trucks, therefore reducing fuel consumption. Another important aspect is the all the platoon members are communicating via wireless protocols with each other. So if one of the truck, for example, the first truck breaks, all the other trucks immediately know that braking action as well and can immediately react on it. So also reducing head-tail collisions, for example, and increasing general safety is part of this truck platooning example. One of the goals of TNO, as I said before, is to bring applications to the real world. And the aim of the project that we did here on truck platooning was to actually bring the platooning application to the public road. Therefore, we had to work together with the Dutch road authorities to explain them about the safety of the application and show that it's capable of handling all kinds of situations. And in the end, we got the road exemption and we could proceed with this project on the public road. In the meantime, we took part in many more truck platooning related projects, European Truck Platooning Challenge, and also we are leading a large consortium on multi-brand truck platooning in a European project. Next, I will show you a video on a typical truck platooning design example, starting from paper design, through simulation, through test track work, to public road. Okay, welcome back. let me proceed to the next slide. So due to our vast domain knowledge on the topic of truck platooning, we can support the Japanese industry on this topic in various ways. We can consult, for example, on architecture designs for these kind of applications, on safety cases. We can also co-develop integrated safety systems together. For example, on automated lane change applications or traffic jam assist applications. Furthermore, it is possible to assist in the testing of such applications, and therefore we have designed a simulation environment to test, for example, the software of such applications. But on the other hand, we also have the availability of a public test road very nearby our TNO offices, in which roadside units are monitoring, for example, the traffic flow of this part of highway, and can be communicated to the application in the trucks or in passenger vehicles. And furthermore, we can also assist in discussions with, for example, the Japanese road authorities on harmonization, on regulation and legislation. Next example is yard automation. Here, the main driver is efficient and sustainable logistics, and the challenge is to connect multiple autonomous vehicle platforms, to a logistics system. All these autonomous vehicles should make their own decisions when they are in operation, for example, on safety and other autonomous tasks. But at the same time, they need to work together in one ecosystem, and they need to perform tasks from the being sent by the logistics system. As I explained before, with level 4, level 5 automation, it will take some time to release those kind of applications to the market. But by restricting the operational design domain of applications like these, for example, lowering the velocity of operating them on non-public or restricted areas, we can decrease maybe the safety requirements for these applications, for that specific application, and then be able to introduce such systems much sooner. For yard automation, that involves the following fields of expertise. Of course, we need to know about the autonomous driving functions, which I have explained before. But another important aspect is communication. How do you ensure that the communication between the logistics platform and the vehicles is safe and reliable? And in case, for example, that a autonomous platform is cannot handle the task of autonomous driving because it sees a situation which it cannot handle, communication can also be important to for a supervisor placed in a control room, for example, to take over live the control of such a vehicle and move it to a safe location. So communication should be safe, reliable, and cyber secure. Furthermore, logistics systems need to be also in place in these kind of applications. And then it's very as required. Then you should ask yourself, what kind of information should be sent from the autonomous vehicles to the logistics system, and what kind of information do the autonomous vehicles need to fulfill that task? So both on communication and also on logistics systems, TNO has departments working on these questions. The applications for these kind of technologies can be, of course, in distribution centers or container handling at harbors, but also in automated public transport. Last example is the interaction of autonomous vehicles with other humans, especially outside the vehicle. The main challenge here, research challenge, is to reduce accidents with vulnerable road users, and the challenge is here to improve the interaction between vehicles and humans. This is being explained by the following illustration. For example, a pedestrian trying to cross the road, he sees a car coming up. He doesn't know whether the car has seen him, because there's no interaction. But the car has seen him, for example, in this case, and the car is slowing down and expects the pedestrian to cross. But still, the pedestrian, having no interaction with the vehicle, doesn't know whether it's safe to cross. And finally, you end up in both waiting for the first one to move. So interaction is very important in these kind of situations. So what kind of interaction should you use in this? Should you use audible signals, sounds, or should you use visual signaling or otherwise? Well, we are not the only ones looking into these topics. Here on the screen you see a lot of applications being designed by various companies, mainly on visualization, visual interfacing. You can use lights, the coloring of lights, you can project text on the vehicle, or you can project images on the ground, all with the aim to not confuse the pedestrian in this case, and showing the intent of the vehicle. Another way, which is hard to show in pictures, is that pedestrians pretty much interact with vehicles on motion patterns. For example, if a pedestrian sees a car coming up and then stopping at large distance, it will give confidence to the pedestrian to cross the road. So motion patterns are also a very is a research topic where TNO is very much looking into on the behavior in the interaction between humans. So not only on behavior models, human behavior models, we are doing research, but also on informing visualization of the visual aspects of interaction with the humans. For that, we have developed processes to integrate flexible LED displays, OLEDs, into curved plastic surfaces, as you can see on the left of this slide. Those can be placed inside the car to inform the drivers, for example, but also on the exterior. Furthermore, flexible LED displays, not only flexible but also stretchable, have been developed, which can be integrated behind textiles, for example, and also mini LED displays can be integrated into glass, into windows. When you present digital content in a visual way, resolution is very important. So therefore, you need to be able to print a lot of, in this case, LEDs, on a very small surface. TNO and Holst has developed processes to do that in a very cheap way, to use cheap polyester substrates to print those bare dye mini LEDs onto. And those LEDs are very small in size. There you can think of a quarter of a millimeter in both directions. Using these kind of substrates required a new process in soldering because the traditional soldering methods require high temperatures. Therefore, also a process of lower temperature soldering has been developed at TNO and Holst to do that. So this brings me to the last slide of my presentation, where I showed you that we are moving towards ever higher levels of automated driving. The key takeaways here are that we have to do it in a safe way, efficient and sustainable, but also the user acceptance of those systems for vulnerable users, for vulnerable road users outside the vehicle, but also on for drivers inside the vehicle. User acceptance is very important. TNO and Holst perform research on all of these levels, on multiple levels, and we can assist you in research and development in these fields. Thank you for your attention. And next up is Lotte, who will speak some final words.